left alone. You had no one to rely on, no one to care for you. A lost soul in search of some kind of shelter and protection. Now where do you run? Where do you hide? Where do you go when you need a hole to crawl in? And welcome to the Good Good Show. I'm Marie LaMonaco, and of course it's Ben Rizzuti. And we're here, and I'm back from my little trip. I was in California for the weekend, and had a great time. It was awesome. I went out there to do some open mics. I tried to get some more stage time, but it was a little difficult getting in contact with people without having my own car and whatnot, and everything being in San Francisco, and I was in LA, so it didn't completely work out. But other than that, I had a great time. I went to the Met game.
Yes, that is.
That was cool.
Game five,
and it was awesome. My friend got tickets, like, randomly. His friend texted him and was like, I got two tickets to this game. Do you want to go? He was like, do you want to go? I'm like, sure. So we went, and we were like the only Met fans there, pretty much, in a sea of Dodger fans, and everybody's going, New York sucks, New York sucks, New York sucks. And meanwhile, we're like, look at the scoreboard, you know? And we won, and the place was dead silence, and I thought for sure we were like going to get beat up. And then it turned out that people were coming up to us after the game going, congratulations, that was a good win. I was like, what? Congratulations? These people are so nice out here. Congratulations. What? I don't believe it. So, it was fun. I did that.
Yeah, in New York, it's different.
Yeah, they're like, go scratch your ass. You know, like, get the hell out of here. Get your friggin' shit and go.
Get out of here.
You know, but it was cool that people were so nice about it. And
did you wear Mets stuff?
Oh, yeah. I had my Mets shirt on, and my friend had his Mets shirt on, and we went there, and they just did not like us in the beginning. But after it was over, you'd think in the beginning they would be like, all right. But after it was over, congratulations, yada, yada.
That's great.
Yeah, so I did that. Yeah. I went to three open mics out there and went to a couple improv shows.
Were you in the improv?
No. I just watched. I shouted out.
Well, you were getting your feet wet, pretty much. You were learning the, you know.
Yeah, there was a group there that was doing from the game Fuck, Marry, Kill. I don't know if you've heard of it. And they ask you, like, who would you want to fuck, who would you want to marry, and who would you want to kill? And people were, like, shouting out stuff from the audience and whatnot. But I was really more observing than anything else because I just wanted to see what they were doing. So that was cool. And what else did I do out there? I went to Universal and went through the Walking Dead haunted house, which we waited on.
Oh, yeah?
For 2.5 hours.
Was it worth it?
It was. It was
The Walking
awesome.
Dead? Yeah,
it was really cool. Like, they really put on a good haunted house there, and a Michael Myers haunted house, too.
That was so sick. Was there a line for that one as well?
Yeah, but it wasn't as long.
The Walking Dead is a big deal.
We were on the line. I'm like, do we even have to go in? We basically are the Walking Dead out here. Like, moving on a slow rate, you know? Like, I'm going to eat someone soon. If we don't get out of here, I'm starving.
But that's amazing. You went, it was more or less like you did the Gagoot show, then 2 days later you flew to California.
Yeah.
And you came back last night.
Last night I came back, and here we are.
That's great.
Did you do this weekend anything?
Yeah, I did work around the house. I froze my ass off.
I heard it snowed a little bit here.
Yeah, not by us, but it snowed a little.
Babylon,
few flakes.
It snowed like a little bit, but
a couple of flakes. And I'm winterizing my house right now, so I didn't really do any shows. I want to see, they're doing the Addams Family at the Addams Family Play, and they're doing it at the CM Performing Arts Center in Oakdale.
I want to go.
So we'll go. You want? It's going to be on weekends, and it's also going to be on Halloween, but around.
I have
Halloween.
A show on Halloween.
You do, yeah? A comedy show?
Yeah, and it's going to be at the Huntington Hilton. I'm doing with just plain Keith, and Isaac and Baker are headlining.
Oh, great.
Yeah, so I'm excited about that one. It's a good show. It's a late show. It's at 10:30, and it's for the MA convention.
Oh, great.
Yeah, that'll be fun. I want to mention this. I recently today was going through some stuff. My dad brought some old boxes from the house, and I found this book here that says Rex on it because apparently I wanted to name my butterfly Rex after a dinosaur. I was going through a dinosaur phase, and I was like, if I can't have a dinosaur, I'm going to name my butterfly Rex.
So you had a pet butterfly?
Kind of. In third grade, we did a project where we grew caterpillars or into butterflies, and we had our eggs, and we watched them go through metamorphosis and turn into butterflies. And I just want to share with you guys a couple things that are in this book, because it's absolutely hilarious. If you notice here, I have like three shades of brown on my rainbow, so that could tell you a lot about how hopeful I am in life.
Your rainbow's not very bright.
No. Rex, that looks like a piece of poop. Which I'd just like to point out, I wrote this in half cursive and half regular print because I was in third grade and didn't know how to write. Rex, small and smelly, crawly, wiggly, growing, smart, cool caterpillar. Nice, Nicole, really nice. Then I wrote this little thing here with this awesome picture that I drew of myself.
That was you?
Yeah, that was me and my butterfly
and
Rex.
Butterfly Rex.
And a beautiful sky with absolutely no background. Yeah. Or just an open field. This little thing was called When You Are Set Free. That's what it's entitled. When you are set free, you will fly in the open, then circle around me. It will fly away and then come back like light. It will fly away forever. It will meet a girlfriend, make eggs, and then die. Awesome, Nicole, really. This is May 23rd of 1996, by the way. What I like the most and the worst about Rex. I like when he or she had larvae. I didn't like when I had to feed him or her because it smelled bad. I didn't like when I had to set them free, because I wanted to hold them captive in my basement. Butterfly ceremony. The ceremony was sad, but I was happy they were set free. Now I was happy that they were set free. First I wanted to keep them, now I wanted to set them free. A walking contradiction I am. Things have not changed for me really much since third grade. That's okay. But I was happy they were set free. They seemed happy to be free. I would be too. I hope he's happy. With this picture of the dark sky and some trees.
Okay. So you set them free at night.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if that's a moon. I don't know if that's a sun. I don't know what that is. And then I drew this awesome picture here, if you notice, with just some random colors and whatnot.
So, yeah, black and blue.
My teacher wrote, good work at the back. Really? Do you think this was good work? All right.
Where is that teacher now?
I would like to know. I don't know. So, yeah, I just found this and thought it would be amusing to read here.
You should publish that for Christmas.
I should write a book about this. I don't know. I'm just going to get this. This is going to be Christmas presents that I give to people this year. I'm just going to get printed copies of it, a hard copy, and be like, here's a third grade project I worked on.
That's a great...
Merry Christmas.
Yeah. You don't even wrap it.
Yeah. Give it to them like this. Hope you like it. I don't know.
You should get like some butterflies and put them in.
Yeah, like dead, but just dead butterflies and just like smear them in there. Smush them in. What? I thought it was nice. Oh, yeah.
No, that's nice though. Story time. This has been story time with Nicole LaMonica.
There you go.
You like reading little children's
books. I don't know why. I like to read children's books. It's not creepy at all.
No. Be creepy if I like to read children's
books. Yes, it would be. What were you like in third grade? You remember? Like, would you remember in elementary school?
I remember I had a teacher, and her name was Miss Berger. And then she got married, and her name became Mrs. Netrida. But I was, they said, and I kind of know, I used to daydream a lot. So when they were talking about math and, you know, history.
Comedian daydreaming? What?
I would daydream. But when it came to English, I was great. And I got bad grades in high school. And then I remember my report card was horrible, atrocious. And then in English one time, everybody, you know, they'd be like, what did you get? And I never wanted to. So English, this was now seventh grade. This was middle school. And what did you get in English? And I looked and I went, I got an A. And the teacher looked at me and she was like, yeah. Yeah, you got it. And I was like, oh my God, there's an A. What are my parents going to think?
At least you got an A in something.
And then I knew from that teacher, I knew that that English was where I wanted to go. But
English was the probably the only subject that I liked writing. I didn't like reading, which is weird, but I liked to write. And my comprehension, what is the word? What I'd write, my punctuation and stuff is all off. I'm still off with it. It's terrible. But, you know, really quick story before we go to our commercial break is that I was in first grade and I had a teacher, Mrs. Mulholland, and she called on me. And if you remember, in first grade, you have the alphabet above the chalkboard. And she goes, Nicole LaMonaco, please come up and point out the vowels. And you have that long stick and you have to point it to the thing.
Yeah, the pointer,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So I'm like, all right. So I get up there and I'm like, A, E, 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 I guess this isn't really a quick story, but, and I was standing there, I was sweating, I remember like freaking out, just sweating, I didn't know the vowels, I was like, oh my God, I don't know. And I stood there, and what felt like the longest 2 minutes of my life, and I'm like, I don't know. And she called on this girl who was always a goody-two-shoes, knew everything, Erin. And she goes, Erin, can you please come up here and help Nicole find the vowels? I'm like, sat there like a Mama Luke, like, mm. She's like, A, E, I, O, and U, and sometimes Y. I wanted to backhand this little girl so bad. So I was like devastated that day because I felt like such an idiot. But now I know them. I know.
You know your vowels.
I know
now.
The vowels.
And what good do they do for us?
Nothing. They just are confusing.
Even great. Some of your greatest writers got thrown out of school and weren't great.
I'm sure
school.
They did. You know, I just felt like an idiot up there. And she burned that into my brain. And I was just like, and from that point on, I never wanted to be called on school again. I never rose my hand. And I was just like, please just ignore me. Anyway, that's my story. That was probably dumb to even tell. But it's cool. So we're going to go to a quick commercial break.
Oh, wait. And before we go to the break, I want to say, we forgot to mention, we have guests tonight.
Yeah, we do. I was going to get
oh,
to
you
that.
Gonna
but
get
I was
going to
say,
sorry.
We have two guests tonight. We have a magician that goes by the name of
Scott Interante.
And then we have a dancer here from Madhouse TV that's going to be joining us a little later on, who's into stand-up comedy as well, who's interested in it. Her name is Natalie Boyle, and we'll bring them on a little later on in the show. We'll be right back. You're watching The Gugooch Show on
madhousetv.com.
Hey everybody, I want to tell you about something phenomenal. A casino night, November 13th, Bets for Vets. We're going to have some big headliners there. Tommy Marr, rock and roll legend from Long Island. Les Deegan is going to be there singing some crooning songs. We're going to have two phenomenal comedians, Tim Thompson and impersonator comedian John Santos. We're going to have a great DJ there. $20 admission. The door opens up at 6 p.m. November 13th. And it's 370 Vanderbilt Motor Parkway in Hopog. 6 p.m. November 13th. $20 admission. The doors open up at 6 p.m., plus a complete casino night. We'll have blackjack, slot machines, you name it. It will be there. Grand prizes, 50-50, door prizes, things like flat-screen TVs. I mean, this is going to be big. So mark your calendars for November 13th. Please, guys, come out. Support our veterans.
Hi, everyone. Hey. I'm Karen Vito from the hit show Shake It Up with Karen and Regina. That's filmed live right here at Madhouse TV. I want to thank Madhouse TV for allowing me to talk to you today about a very important organization called Mondays at Racine. Mondays at Racine provides beauty and wellness services to those undergoing chemotherapy and radiation for cancer. We have an event coming up on Monday, October 26th at the Crest Hollow Country Club called the Long Island Beauty Ball. The Long Island Beauty Ball is going to be the event of the year. I want you to come down and join us. Do things like the lash bar and the lipstick lounge, and we're going to have psychics and, of course, a beer garden and wine garden. We even have a Monday Night Football for you guys. So I would love to see you there at this event. If for whatever reason you can't make it, you could always donate directly to mondays@racine.org. But for ticket information, please go to www.longislandbeautyball.com. This organization will use the money raised at this event for the expansion of the program to other salons all over the country. So we would love to be able to treat more people and help them feel really special. So please come on down. I'll see you there. Thanks.
Are we in yet?
Yeah.
And we're back. We're back. What a surprise.
Ta-da.
Ta-da. We're here with our guests, Natalie Boyle and Scott Interante.
What's up?
What's up? Good to see you.
Thanks and Nicole is here.
And me.
Can so why don't you both tell us a little about yourself, and we'll start with you, Natalie.
Sure. Well, my day job is I work in marketing, and I've done that for two national companies. So I'm a corporate trainer for institutions that work with banks and credit unions, basically. So I like that. I'm helping people every day. But my real passion is dancing. I've been dancing as a kid, ballet and tap, and then for the last 14 years I've been dancing as a clog dancer.
A clog dancer?
Irish step.
Wait a minute, that's awesome. Are they heavy on your feet to be dancing in?
Well, we don't wear the wooden clogs like they used to. 300 years ago, we wear tap shoes.
Okay.
So it's like Riverdance, if you ever saw that.
Yeah.
And it's really fast and furious. It's really cool to watch.
Oh.
And we do venues all over the place. I've done shows, you know, in festivals and nursing homes and schools. And I just took over the business because the former founder passed away.
Okay.
So it's very exciting, sad in one way, but very exciting because it's a new opportunity to take this and
go
further.
Do you teach it at all?
I am teaching. And I also teach country line dancing, which I just started. And that's my new passion for 1 year.
Cool.
I've been doing that, and that's really fun.
Awesome. So, where do you do that? I've seen so many people get so interested in line dancing. I had no idea that there was that many people out there that are so into line dancing.
I know. Believe it or not, on Long Island, it's pretty hot right now. So I follow a band that, you know, plays the country and southern rock music.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's followers that go, probably about 80 people or so, that I've just learned and become friends with and learned from them. And I finally decided, after being approached God knows how many times, people would run up to me and say, do you do this? Do you teach? You know, I decided, let's do this. So
yeah.
I just started.
Awesome.
So I teach out in Hampton Bays because the East End doesn't have any instructors. And I'm loving it.
Cool.
I'm living the dream.
That's awesome. It's fun great. To
And you have an interesting comedy.
I love comedy. Are you kidding? Who doesn't?
Like, right? Who doesn't like to laugh?
Well, I like when you're talking with somebody and you're on the same vibe and you can play off something funny that they say and then you keep going and you have that clever wit. I like that. I enjoy that. But I love just escaping sometimes and going and just watching comedy because it just helps you to just unwind. It's just fun.
Who's your favorite comedian?
Oh, gosh. Oh. I couldn't even tell you. I've seen so many over the years, local. I think the one I always thought was funny that I would laugh out loud at is Ellen.
I love
DeGeneres.
That.
Yeah. I think she is so funny on her show, and she dances, so how could you not like her?
Exactly.
Yeah. Ellen's got to get some clogs on, though, and do a little clog dance there.
Oh, I've done that. I did my first little gig here at Madhouse was with Jerry Parisi, and I did a little dancing in my tap shoes.
That's good.
You should try and send Ellen some videos of you. Maybe she'll put you on her show.
Oh, wouldn't that be something?
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe we'll, Ellen will
Ellen,
open
are
her show.
Watching this clogging. Show? We're going to send you this tape.
Ellen loves this show.
She does. She's a huge fan. No,
I heard her mention you.
I'm gonna put this episode on Twitter, and then I'm gonna tag her, or hashtag or whatever you do there. Hashtag.
All right, Nicole. Nicole's got it.
Hashtag it.
She's so nice. She doesn't even know it. Yeah. Hashtag.
That's what we call it.
I look forward to that. That's
yeah.
Cool.
Oh, great.
Can I ask you something about clogging? How come?
Well,
is that what you're calling
you
clogging?
Too.
Clogging.
How you call it?
It's the name of the dance.
It's better than flogging.
Well, not really.
Well, I guess if you're into that sort of
back
thing.
Back in the 1800s.
No, but when people are flogging or clogging, let's use clogging for an example. How come you don't see a lot with their arms? I always notice their arms just kind of like look. Who was that guy with Riverdance? You mentioned Riverdance.
Michael Flatley.
Yeah, well, and the arms are by the side, and the legs are going like this, and the arms are just kind of like this. I mean, you know, it just reminds me of that. I'm sorry, I'm not insulting
you. It's not an insulting thing because,
it's like a marionette. And
because you talk about comedy, you know, and stuff like that, that you like comedy when it just happens and it goes back and forth. I watch that, and I have tears rolling down my eyes because their arms, they look like they're... You know, hate to say it, partially paralyzed. There's nothing funny about that. Trust me, there's nothing funny about it. But when you're paying tickets,
something a little funny about it.
Well, it's also, is it?
Yeah, not the fact that they're paralyzed. No. Just the fact that they look paralyzed.
Well, the thing is, it just looks like it's from like a from the waist up. Even their facial expression just kind of. I mean, watch it next time. I mean, just go like this to the bottom of the screen, and they look like they're floating on this little thing.
Like their legs are flamboyant from the rest of the
yeah.
body.
All right, you know? let me just because
with
dance, fun?
No,
you
what
done
is it? Fun? No, actually not. But with dance, I'm so used to jazz hands, you know, and you don't see any of that. Maybe
no,
because it's 300 years ago, and they used to wear clogged shoes and.
Right, but let me distinguish.
Yes,
clog dancing really isn't what you're talking about. That is Irish step, soul Irish step. Which is a little bit of clogging, but not, they're two different things, two different forms of dance, truthfully. But we do clog dancing with some of those, the Irish step, steps in them. So that's really, there's an influence there, because clogging is actually from the Scottish, the Welsh, and the Irish. So, but while there's an influence, it's not so, so we don't do that. Our style.
So you're saying they move their hands a little bit?
Absolutely. I move my arms, I gesture, and I do move. Because you're free to do that when you clog dance. It's your own personal style. The Irish step dancers that are trained solely in that, they don't move. That's just their style. They stay straight and almost like pencils, and they move their legs. But if you look at the footwork, it's absolutely incredible to watch them. Because they're like, they sound like a drum. I mean, they have such rhythm and heavy shoes, very heavy, compared to what I wear. So that's the difference. So now you're in life.
No, that's good. That's great.
Now, what do you do so we can make fun of it?
So let's make fun of you now.
I can make fun of what I know. You know, I mean, basically, I'm a liar, a cheat, a fake, and a fraud, but I'm honest about it. Now, I'm a magician, but as Benny knows, I know Benny for 35 years and everything else. We used to make fun of clogging back then. No. No, but Benny and I...
That's why you contacted me.
No. But yeah, I'm a magician, and that's how I met Benny. We work in, the orphanage in Patchogue.
The orphanage in Patchogue, yes.
Wow. And I was really a magician, no comedy or anything else, but in order to sell my magic, I had to come up with different ways. So one of them was introduce some comedy in there where the magic didn't work, then it did work and everything else. But getting into magic was, since I was a little kid.
Well, I thought it was interesting. He just shared with me out there that you went to Australia?
Yeah, I was in Australia. That was my first world tour. Was I was 17. I had my 18th birthday in New South Wales, Australia, with a magician I was working with, James Randi. The Amazing Randi, his name was. And
do you know him
too? No.
But he was a pretty famous magician back in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and he's actually the guy who starts the James Randi Educational Foundation and what they do. See, being magicians and everything else, we're kind of like, we're aware of the tricks and scams and everything else. I mean, that's, like I said, I'm a liar, a fake, a fraud, and everything else, but I'm honest about it. I'm telling you that what I do isn't real. Now, if somebody doesn't tell you that, they could get away with pretending they're psychics. So this is what Randi did, taking over after Houdini, believe it or not. Houdini was really the first guy to do it. He'd see these people doing mind-reading things and pretend to be telling their fortunes, and they're doing, you know, simple tricks that now you can find on the back of cereal boxes. But they're so well disguised that you don't even recognize the techniques. So anyway, Randi, he's in Australia, he's got this tour going, and he's trying to give away, at the time it was $10,000. And then it became $60,000, and then $1 million, thanks to Johnny Carson. When Johnny Carson left in his will $1 million to go after these frauds and shysters and everything else, every other adjective you want to call them, which I won't call them here, but you can imagine the adjectives I want to call them, because they're crooks. And,
we need the ratings.
And he's like, come on, call them.
Call them. I've been fooling the king.
These guys are... I got rid of the adjective before.
So,
asshole.
So
that's what I said. Asshole.
You could say asshole.
No, but a lot of these guys, you know, I mean, let's be realistic here. If one of the tests that we were trying to give away the money for was dowsing, which is basically two metal rods, and they would cross. You know, you'd hold on to them like a stick.
Right.
Look it up. It's really amazing. And people pay money for this because we're going to find water underneath the ground. And they walk around with these sticks, and all of a sudden, supposedly magnetic fields or whatever. It's their story. I don't know. And the sticks dip, and they go, oh, there's water here. So sure enough, you dig far enough, you're going to find water. And they go, oh, here's your money and everything else. And basically, any place you dig, eventually, you keep digging far enough, you're going to find water. So we were testing them. All right, you can see if the water's moving. So we put some pipes and everything in the ground, covered it back up again, and turned one of them on and the rest of them off and said, find the one where the water is. When they knew where it was flowing, they hit it every single time. But when it came down for the money, no better than chance. Anyway, so that's why I was in Australia, and that's how I got started in magic.
You were just talking about digging, and for some reason my mind just went to when I was at the beach. I would dig holes in the sand, and my mom would be like, what are you digging in China? And I honestly, in my heart, believed that I was going to be able to dig to China, and like I pictured digging like in the hole, and I was going to catch like underneath like all these like people driving and Asian people and stuff. I don't think this is what I thought was gonna happen.
Well,
my imagination,
I think we all did,
like,
that at some point.
You did?
Yeah.
I'm not alone.
Huge. No. Yeah, at the beach.
But did you think you were gonna find China?
Well, whatever was on the other side of where we were.
Yeah.
The thing is, it's funny you say China, because I figured if I was across the street, would I wind up in something like, you know, by Egypt maybe or something? Not realizing you have to go a little bit further than across the street to get through. But. Wow, you're making me think way back.
How did it all get started for you?
I saw this matzah. Can I show you? My grandfather showed me a trick with a cracker. This is a matzah, and my last name is Interanti, so you can imagine we didn't
half
have a lot of these.
Yeah,
exactly. But I can see it's perforated, so we're just going to try and... Oh, there we go.
Perfect.
And then where it's not perforated, we're just going to make more of a mess.
All right.
There's a vacuum here or something?
We'll clean it up.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because we've got a little crumbs, but I'll show you. Well, actually, this is a little bit bigger than my grandfather used to use a saltine cracker. And then I updated the trick by using a Ritz cracker. Then on bad days, I would use a Hi-Ho because they were a little cheaper. All right. Anyway, this is a little trick my grandfather showed me. Where, no, that's all right. Almost like a church thing you were doing. I was always wondering, why in church you have to do this? What is the priest, like, drunk from the wine? Are you might drop in at the end? I don't know. Anyway, this is a little trick my grandfather showed me. I was about, a little wad about that big, I guess. Benny likes when I call it a little wad. I don't know why, but that's an expression.
He used to kill us doing that.
Yeah, now it's obviously not working anymore,
just because Benny goes, he used to kill us when I do that. Me.
Just me. Under his breath.
And Benny was the only...
Steve. No, it was
and
me.
It's still the same way it was. Benny would be the only person laughing in the entire...
Me and Steve. Steve and I.
Steve,
and we had seen him like 100
Steve
times.
Steve out in California. Wonderful comedian and everything else. Doing great. In case you ever watched Steve. Hey, Steve. Now we got a reason to send it to him, and he has to watch. Now, don't turn it off, because we're going to mention your name again at the end of the show. And wonderful context, too, so you really want to stick around and hear what we have to say later. All right, this is a little trick. All right, my grandfather would show me. What he would do...
Are you
going to
eat that?
No, I'm not going to eat it. But he would take the cracker and place it in his left hand like this, close his left hand, and reach in the air for some magic waffle dust, sprinkle it over the cracker. It was the wiffle dust that did it. You have to get it all, or else it doesn't work. See? Mm-hmm. Like that. And then you go. And the cracker would be gone.
That's amazing.
It is amazing.
Wait, but how did you do that?
Well, it's a crummy trick. But actually, really, I know what you're asking. How did you do that? Because what you're doing is you're making it look like it goes inside the left hand like that. And even when I show you my hand empty like this, I still am holding the cracker in hand. You can't see it. See? It's still there.
And
you can't see it.
I know.
I just can't do that. I figured you might want me to teach you a magic trick.
All right.
I mean, that's why I'm kind of showing you it. Do you want me to really teach you a magic trick?
But my kids are
I would love to learn a magic trick.
Well, I want you to teach you this trick during a commercial break.
All right.
See how quick you
Sounds
can.
Good.
Okay.
And
we'll be right back. You're watching The Cagoot Show on MadHouseTV.com.
My name is Dr. Robert Brevard. I'm here for Multimedicine in Westbury, New York. We're located at 1065 Old Country Road, Suite 214. Been here for about 15 years. The practice has medical doctors, physical therapists, chiropractors, acupuncturists. We also do pain management, and we have orthopedists on staff. Here at Advanced Multimedicine Rehabilitation, we've got physical therapists on staff who treat an array of conditions, from neck pain to back pain, shoulder pain. We treat carpal tunnel. We treat a lot of car accident patients, slip and falls. We treat patients with knee injuries, with ankle injuries. We have state-of-the-art equipment. We've been here for over 15 years. We do a vast array of diagnostic testing, from x-rays to EMGs. What is an EMG? It's a diagnostic test that allows a doctor to determine where the pinched nerve is. Cora is a physical therapist at Advanced Multimedicine and Rehabilitation. She's working on Stephanie, who was involved recently in an automobile accident. Stephanie has tight thoracic and cervical musculature, and Cora is doing some myofascial release work and some therapeutic stretching doing it to help her with her pain. Vicky is also a patient here at Advanced Multimedicine and Rehabilitation. Vicky is now working her leg muscles, specifically her quadricep muscles, trying to strengthen them after an injury she sustained. Find yourself in need of any type of physical therapy, please don't hesitate to call Advanced Multimedicine and Rehabilitation, located in Westbury, New York, in Suite 214. Phone number is 516-334-7000, or find us on our website at advancedmultimedicine.com.
Professional motorcycle transport and towing, think Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing. Proudly serving all of Long Island, we feature expert handling and 24/7 service. So send a limo for your toy with Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing.
And we're back on our Gagoot Show, and I didn't learn the trick on the commercial break because I wanted you guys to be able to learn it at home, and we all want to learn it together. So let's see what you got. I'm so
okay,
curious.
Okay, I'm gonna. You ever seen the trick where the magician saws a woman in half?
Yeah.
Well, we're not gonna learn that one. All right. You ever see the one where they tear a newspaper up and then put it back together again? We're going to learn that one, okay? But not with a newspaper. I mean, we're just going to learn it with the paper napkin, which I got outside in your little green room there. Here's the paper napkin. Now, in order to do this trick, you need something else. Of course, we're going to tear this up. We're going to put it back together, all right?
Right.
You need something else,
okay,
which I prepared that nobody knows about, and that's another paper napkin.
Oh,
shh. Because we're going to switch them, and that's how it's done. Because if you really think I could put a paper napkin together, you're kidding, right? Yes, it's just a trick. Okay. Let me get that out. All right. So here's the paper napkin, all right? I already rolled it up into a light, tight little ball, and what you do is you hide that inside your hand, okay? Like this, three fingers, that's called finger palming.
Okay.
All right? Because the fingers are holding it up against the palm, hence the name finger palming. If you hold it with your thumb up against the palm, that's called thumb palming, okay? I kind of like thumb palming a little bit. So make sure when you do this, you start off like this, you show the napkin, and you're all set. All right, real important.
All right.
When you do this, make sure you hold the napkin out like this, and this hand has the other thing.
People are in front of you, so they can't see.
They're where the camera is, okay? Nobody sees this. You can't go, hi, everybody. All right, you got to do it like this. And if you do this like at a party or a classroom or something, if you're going to do it, you stroll in and you use this hand to gesture towards this. So you go, look, a paper napkin. You don't have to do it like that, but make sure this hand is at, you know, really natural position like that. Okay, here. And then you point towards the napkin. Then you take the napkin and you tear it. Like that, tear it straight in half. Okay, all right. Well, the guys on TV, they're able to tear it in half.
Right.
You know, this is web TV, all right. So you take it and you roll it up. Make sure nobody sees that.
Right.
Nobody sees that one.
Okay.
They're all looking here, all right?
See, I kind of imagine that magicians are better men are better at being magicians because their hands are bigger.
No, even the size of the hands really doesn't matter. It's the misdirection. It's misdirection.
Okay.
That's real important, really. Well, with this trick, yeah, it helps maybe because of the napkin. All right, so what you're going to do is you have this napkin here, and then you say, I place the napkin over here, and you do that. As soon as you do that, as soon as you put the napkin up here, don't let them see that one here. You reach into your pocket. I have in my pocket a magical coin, which I'm going to reach in and I'm going to take out. This is called misdirection. It doesn't have to be. I have this gold coin here. There we go. It's not really gold. It's plastic. But it's all right. For the sake of the thing, I saw that back there, so that was okay. All right? Now, this hand is still this way.
Right.
So you take the coin, you go, one, two, three, right? And you take the coin, you put the coin away and everything, and you go, like that, and you shove the napkins back together again, just like that. Remember, this stays here.
Thumb,
right? You open it up, and sure enough, ta-da, the napkin is back together again into one piece, and that's the secret to the famous torn and restored napkin trick, just like that.
Let me ask you a pretty good trick. Have you ever dropped the other napkin?
Well, that's where you got to be really, really careful. That's where the magic coin comes in, because if that happens, you just take the magic coin and you touch it to these pieces too. One, two, three, like that.
Oh.
And then you see what happens is that also comes back together again into one piece. So it's real important that you don't tell anybody how the trick is done, and you don't drop the paper napkin, because otherwise then you're going to really need the magic coin. Now, paper napkins are really, really inexpensive. You know, you can get the package of these for $1 in the dollar store and everything else. But these magic gold coins, well, you can only get them at www. No, <geez. laughs>
That was
a little magic trick.
Wow.
So last time you're going to invite me here, because I'm really making
you
a mess.
You caught me by surprise with that one.
Whoa!
Because I thought the other one was still going to be ripped up.
That's the beauty of magic.
No,
and the gold coin that he reached into his pocket to get.
Oh, okay.
You know what, Benny?
I get it.
It's a little something for you.
Third clue.
Keepsake.
All right.
That's right. You hang that on your wall inside there. And you say, I remember the day when I got so excited when he made a mess of my floor and he did a paper napkin.
And I had the vacuum while everybody else was having fun.
And the only one who was really smart there were the two girls on the show and everything. They just sat there and went, okay, how much longer is this show going to go on?
The two blondes were smarter than me.
That's right.
Well, now you got some other stuff here. You're going to show us a couple more.
I want to know more about your dancing thing, because magicians always, it's customary, magicians always use dancers.
That's very cool.
That's true.
I mean, really, because when
we can hitch kick and we can just curl up into a little ball and jump out.
Distract the heck out of the audience.
Right. That's right. That's right. No one's looking at that box unless you got a good-looking girl inside of it. That I can promise you. Because if you stick a guy inside the box, nobody cares.
You're going to saw him in half. You've done those tricks, you said.
Yeah, actually. I have.
All right. I just want to say real briefly. I had seen him when he was just a comedy club act. Then I saw him because he was like, now I want to do the real. So I saw him in a comedy club do the real, make a girl go from here to over there. Then I saw him perform, which now was 20 years ago, in the Vanderbilt Museum in the garage. He did a whole Scott Interante show with different, he did the rings and he worked from the little magic to the sawing people in half. And then I saw him at Five Towns with my son. Took my son to see him, and it was another spectacular. So he does that spectacular magic act.
Yeah, back when I was touring, I was hitting the different colleges and going to different museums and everything, and I had a couple of different shows set up. One was called Deceptions. The other one was Houdini's Escapes and Illusions, The Incredible Universe of Magic and Illusion, which we did the Vanderbilt. We converted their garage. I don't know if you're familiar out here on Long Island, the Vanderbilt Museum.
Yeah, sure. The sanitarium is, right?
I was telling Benny this over the phone, and he says, don't say anything. Mention it when we get there. But we took over their garage, where they used to keep their cars, and we called it the Turntable Theater. And it was like, why is it the Turntable Theater? Well, Fred DeFay, who used to own the Arena Players, it was the first community theater out here on Long Island. He was the one who, you know, broke it, this whole deal. Arena Players presented my show. So we went into this garage, and there was a turntable in the floor. And I was like, what is this? He says, oh, the Vanderbilts used to pull their cars in. Now, we're talking about late 1800s, early 1900s, and they didn't have reverse yet. So they would pull the cars in. They had no way of getting them out. So he built a turntable that turned very slowly, so the car would turn around so we could pull it out of the garage. So I was like, well, how are we going to do a show? We're going to tape up the whole floor. We're going to throw down the carpet. We're going to do this. We're going to do that and everything else.
Oh,
we built
my
up,
God.
And it was a solid floor. So there were no trap doors anyway. So we had to come up with all of these weird methods of doing. Yeah, because magicians do use mirrors. They use trap doors. They use all of these things. You never see it.
Right.
And they're never in the tricks that you really think they're in. It's when you don't think we're using them. That's when we're using them. You know,
yeah.
I'm being honest with you. But, yeah, so that was a unique show that Benny came out to see. But
and the Five Towns was another great
Five Towns was a little easier. It was up on a professional stage. We only had the audience in front of us. It wasn't like kind of in the round and everything else. But
and as I said, like he had lovely assistants with him.
Exactly. I mean, Danae was working with me in all the shows. And she, you know, you put her in the box. Everybody kept their eyes on the box and everything. But being limber is what it was all about. Danae really wasn't a dancer. But she, you know, practiced with the illusions. Dancers usually don't have to practice so much because they're familiar with the type of movement and everything else. We don't have illusions that work great if you're a clogger, but in other forms of dance. But and also, you guys
it's
are in good shape. I'm sure it is. I'm sure it is. Anything physically active.
So now, aren't you called an illusionist? Don't you call yourself that?
Yeah, an illusionist, a deceptionist, the magician. Magician is mostly with small stuff. Illusionist usually means, you know, working with living things or really big things, making a car disappear, an airplane disappear, or, you know, real big illusions.
That's always intriguing. Like when one person disappears and appears somebody somewhere else.
Yeah, I mean, they've been doing that for 150 years, and then it disappeared for a little while because everyone was getting into the card tricks, and that's really famous now. If you go to restaurants, sometimes there's guys walking around doing card tricks and coin tricks and everything, personalized magic show. The close-up magic, and that's great. I love that, too. The problem is, you know, making a living doing close-up magic, you're working so intimately that you really can't, you know, it's a great hobby thing, but to make a living out of it, very few people could do it.
Yeah.
You know, because...
seems tough.
And you can't, past 40, 50 people, nobody could see.
That's true.
You know.
True. You worked with Chris Angel, too, right?
Yeah, I used to give Chris Angel his first magic lessons when he was a kid.
Really?
Yeah, I knew his whole family. I still do. It's still in touch. And, yeah, Chris and I were partners in an act called Mirage for a long time, and then he went off to Las Vegas and...
He's at the Luxor.
At the Luxor. He's got a 10-year contract at the Luxor.
I got kicked out of the Luxor.
You've been kicked out of worse places than that.
Yeah.
You don't know. The Luxor, and then I worked on his TV show also, the consultant for the TV show with many of the illusions. I created a lot of illusions for magicians that I'm not allowed to talk about, but one of them, I guess I could mention it, was for Chris's show in Mind Freak, a couple of illusions I've created.
Cool.
That he performed.
That's cool.
Yeah. So you find ways of making a living doing what you do.
And he's amazing. When he has another show, I tell everybody to go. And my family, you're right. He's a household name in my family because, like, Ryan hasn't saw you in 2006. And I said, Scott Interante is going to be on the show. Ryan said, I am going to watch this show because of
Thanks,
Scott.
Thanks, Ryan.
It's funny because when I told my family that I was going to be on the Benny Rizzuti, you know, Gagut show.
The Gagut show, yes.
They said, who? No, I'm teasing, man. You know I'm teasing you.
Hey, I love you.
Hey, thank you so much for inviting me, though. That I have to say. And with such a lovely guest. Would you want to help me with a trick?
I would.
Yeah, we've got about 10 minutes left.
Oh, that's it?
Yeah, we got about 10. I just burped, excuse me. You might have heard that. about 10 minutes or so.
Uh-oh. This is a bodily function show.
Yeah. Exactly. Do we have enough time to do a couple tricks?
I mean, I feel like I'm taking over the whole show.
This is what we have here.
It's totally fine. Yeah.
All right,
we don't have to go to your next show. That's the one.
Well, that's all right. Well,
you have to have me dance.
If you can't come to my show, the show will come to you.
Okay,
Natalie? Yeah, this is a straitjacket, although, we don't call it a straitjacket anymore because in these days of politically correct things, we have to call it a bi-jacket. Because it's non-sexual, it's any-sexual, it's really not anything, you know. Okay. And we're going to unbuckle it here. You see how the buckles work, right?
Right.
Well, I don't know. Do you want me to escape out of it, or does somebody want to wear it out of the show?
I want to wear it.
You need to
wear
it.
You want me to escape out of it?
I do want you to escape out. I kind of want to wear it.
Okay, well, I'll tell you what. How about you examine it? You examine
it
first.
Yeah, let me see.
It's pretty heavy, so you can put it on, examine
it. All right, let's see how it works.
That's
it. Is this right? Okay.
It looks good on you, I have to say.
All right, let's see if I can try and get out of it.
All right, you want to do that?
Yeah, I want to try. Is this the right way?
She's probably going to ask you the
thumbs and balloons. Then we're not going to have enough time for me to escape.
No, we will. We could do it.
Well, it's a little...
Just do like two buckles. I'm not going to be able to
do it. All right, I'll do that one and that one.
I'm crazy, but I don't know how to get out of it.
All right, I'll do that one. Give me this.
Okay.
And this.
All right.
Oh, you're bringing back a lot of memories for me, Benny. I want you to know that.
I'm looking at this picture. I think that, Nicole, this should be your Christmas card.
All right. Actually,
with a Santa hat in the straight.
I'm putting this back on after the show so we can take pictures with
it. All right, I'm trying to get through here. You know what's really weird? I get out of these. I never put them on anybody.
Oh.
So I'm making it a little loose for you because I don't want to hurt you or anything.
I can get out.
But if you were putting it on me, there you go.
All right. Obviously, this is as far as I could go here. So I'm going to, I don't know.
There you go. Well, you got that far.
Oh.
That's good. Well, you don't have the crotch strap on either, so you also don't have the other buckles in the back there.
All right, but that's about as far as I could get, because I can try, but I can't get out.
I know, it feels like a big mishmash back there, doesn't it? You need help?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
All right. But you did actually pretty good on it. All right, but we also put it on you sitting down there.
All right,
so.
Let's put it on you.
All right, well, make sure there's no trapdoors, invisible strings, right, or anything that'll help me. No Velcro.
No Velcro.
I can assure you it's not there. If there was, I've been doing it the hard way for all these years.
Yeah.
That was right. Okay?
Yeah.
And Natalie, you get to check it out also.
Okay.
There you go. Mm-hmm. All right. That look okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no designer label in there, but I'm sorry about that. All right, Benny, you're going to help me out?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, I'm going to have to stand up here, and I don't want to bang into a microphone or anything.
All right, you're okay.
But we're okay here?
Yeah.
All right, and Natalie, don't worry. You'll get in on the action here in a second. Let me show you the way this works. Into the right sleeve goes the right arm, the left sleeve the left arm. Ben, you want to do me a favor?
Yeah, what do you mean?
Both of you, as a matter of fact. In the back
there. The tightest one?
Yeah, as tight as you can get it. Work your way straight down the back. In fact, while one's doing one buckle, the other could do the other buckle.
This way I'm putting it through the loops, right?
Yeah. Get it, pull it tight and get it through the loops.
All
right. There you go. And do them at the same time.
All right.
So this way we get twice as much done in half the amount of time.
Okay.
So you only got a couple minutes left, I know.
We're good.
We're good?
Yeah.
Okay. When you get all the way down to the bottom, you'll notice one extra buckle.
Yeah.
All right, and that's for our special guest there, Natalie.
Okay.
Here you go, Natalie. Come on.
All right.
Natalie, come on over here. Now do me a favor, you just grab hold of the strap there. That's the short one.
Thank you.
There you go. And fasten that to the buckle in the back.
All right.
And pull on it, make sure it's good and tight.
How's that?
No, really make it tight. Don't be afraid.
Oh, yeah,
pull,
up.
Pull, okay, pull. Up, right. Well, there you go. All right. Yes. Pull, don't jerk. Otherwise, we have to change the rating in the show. There you go.
All right,
fasten it to the other side?
Yep.
Very good. Have you ever done that before?
The whole thing here?
Yeah. Have you ever done that before there?
With this? Yeah, of course.
Yeah?
Of course I have.
Okay. Yeah, we'll just move it away this way they can see. All right, that's good.
All right.
Okay. All right, now we're going to do the arms. Well, there you go, Benny. Grab that to that. And go straight across the back.
Tight.
And make it as tight as you can. You should be able to get all the way to the end there. Go as tight as you can.
All right.
You got all the way to the last one?
Yeah. I'm in the last one.
All right, here we go.
What about those ones on the arms? Those are well done?
These are.
Oh, that's it. Okay.
Okay. Gotcha. You want to check it out? Make sure it's all right? Legit?
It's pretty tight.
Pretty tight?
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm a little heavier than you, so I can assure you it's a little bit tighter on me. All right, there you go. All right.
You're going to do it sitting down?
Well, usually I do this hanging upside down by my ankles because gravity helps me escape out of the straitjacket because it's like pulling it off. But I don't know if I can. No, I'm going to have to stand up and do it, I have a feeling.
So you want to hang over the couch?
Because I'm sure you could wake up south, couldn't you? All right, here we go. When Houdini did this around the turn of the century, he would hang upside down by his ankles and everything. He'd be able to get out in 2 minutes. How he did it, I have no clue. But I'm going to try your way.
Okay.
You notice it's a lot tighter on me as I knew. Which is
it wasn't kind of, it wasn't that tight on me, but
there we go.
All
right, that's the first step. The next step is this down here. I can't get that waist, so we gotta figure this out some other way. Hello.
Hi.
There we go. Here's one. We get this one up. And I think we're probably about a minute and a half by now. A minute and 40 seconds. Now here's the hard part. As we knock everything off your table and break up the set. There we go. The escape from a straitjacket.
Scott Interante.
I like that.
That was great.
I gotta get one of those. Where do you get one of those?
Actually, they're very hard to get right now.
Are they?
Because that's a real straitjacket. It's not one you get in the magic shop or costume store.
Oh,
so
it felt legit.
Yeah, it is legit.
It's too legit to quit.
Well, you really can't have them. They're inhumane.
Oh.
Which
yeah.
I guess is why I like it.
Very cool.
Yeah,
very cool. We didn't take a commercial break.
No.
So I don't know if we're getting.
I think you can get a commercial break, can't you?
Yeah, we could get one in. We'll come back and we'll
and we'll say goodbye.
So you're watching The Gagoot Show on MadhouseTV.com.
With Scott and Natalie. And Nicole.
Buddy, I want to tell you about something phenomenal. A casino night, November 13th. Bets for Vets. We're going to have some big headliners there. Tommy Maher, rock and roll legend from Long Island. Les Deegan is going to be there singing some crooning songs. We're going to have two phenomenal comedians, Tim Thompson and impersonator comedian John Santos. We're going to have a great DJ there. $20 admission. The door opens up at 6 p.m. November 13th. And it's 370 Vanderbilt Motor Parkway in Hop Hog. 6 p.m. November 13th. $20 admission. The doors open up at 6 p.m., plus a complete casino night. We'll have blackjack, slot machines, you name it. It will be there. Grand prizes, 50-50, door prizes, things like flat screen TVs. I mean, this is going to be big. So mark your calendars for November 13th. Please, guys, come out. Support our veterans. Hey everybody, I want to tell you about something.
And we're back. We're going to wrap it up over here, not anymore in the straitjacket, just in general. And that's about it. Thank you guys so much for coming on the show and, you know, showing us
thank
your
you.
Tricks.
Thank
and
you.
Telling
yes.
us about your dancing.
Awesome.
Is there anything anybody wants to plug that...
Do you have any... you could tell us about where people could take dance lessons?
Sure. Knights of Columbus in Hampton Bays. You can visit me on Facebook, Country Dancing with Natalie. And that's how you find me.
Perfect.
Country Dancing with Natalie.
Yes.
I'm going to friend you.
Okay.
All right.
You better.
So I will.
I'm going to be at Bistro B at 9 o'clock in Connecticut on Friday night.
Wow.
So if anybody out in the Connecticut area in Westport, I will be there. So check it out.
Fantastic.
Yeah, you could find it on my Facebook page, comedian Nicole Maria Lamarco. Are you going to be doing anything this week?
Anything? Well, with Halloween around the corner, we'll probably have some kind of Halloween show coming up. We're still in negotiations with that.
Nice.
But I will probably be doing a show without Steve-O. Told you I'd mention you by the end of the show.
And I am going to, I don't have a show this weekend. I have in November, Friday the 13th in November in Queens. So it's great. But this weekend I will be calling and speaking with Steve-O.
Sounds good.
Cool. So, hey, Steve-O.
I feel like I know this Steve-O.
Yeah, I don't. But
great guy.
One day. Anyway, that concludes our night here. And if Genie Powers were with us, you know what she'd say. We'll see you next Tuesday. And have a good night and have a good week. We'll see
you next
week.
Thank you for watching.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Thanks for having me.
You got it.
You were wonderful.